Hello, I'm Nate, and I'm from the Forget the Stigma podcast. And today we have with us Nicola.
Hello.
How are you doing?
Yeah, I'm good, thank you. Good, thank you for having me on.
That's good, good. And today we're going to be talking about my favourite subject, ADHD. Mainly, I'll let Nicola explain her story, but mainly like late diagnosis versus early diagnosis, male versus female. You know, just the typical day-to-day issues and just, yeah, think about ADHD really. So I think we'll get started. Nicola, do you want to start sharing your story of ADHD, how you become an ADHDer?
Yeah, well, so I always thought I was a bit strange, like growing up, I have to say. Anyway, it was after, so 2020, I left an abusive relationship, came into East Sussex, and obviously COVID was around and all that. Anyway, I joined like a sort of support group, and in the support group, like, it was quite bandied around, you know, the word ADHD and neurodivergent. And I hadn't really taken much notice of any of it, to be honest, sort of like over the years, been too busy doing what was happening. And somebody literally turned around. It was a quiet sort of day in this group one day. And they said, "Have you ever thought that you might be ADHD?" And I was like, "No," like, and then literally like yeah, and I was like, "Oh, okay." I from that day went home, and I was literally on TikTok, I was on Instagram, I was like looking at videos, and every video that I looked at, there's a few people that actually do quite a lot of videos about diagnosis in women and the symptoms and stuff. And I was going through, and I was like, yeah. Oh, and then there's a period of sort of like time after you're looking at these videos though, and you're looking, and you're like, so they're all basically me, but maybe I just haven't got ADHD. Maybe it's just, you know, it's just maybe I just can't do life. So you sort of have a bit of imposter syndrome before you even know what that word means.
Did you get, when you first started like the ADHD diagnosis, like the first time you kind of was looking at them videos and seeing it, did you kind of think, "Oh my god, this is my whole personality"?
Yeah, literally.
How could this be so much of my life and so much of me that it just doesn't make sense, is it? Like, where am I in this?
I was like, "Oh my god, I feel seen." And it was actually there's a guy on TikTok and Instagram called Kobe Watts. He's an Australian guy. He was actually one of the first people I started looking at the videos, because he does like funny like videos and stuff, but it's the message behind it is quite serious, you know, sort of giving the symptoms about how it's sort of like sits in women basically, in girls, and he does like for guys as well. And there was another guy, I think Connor DeWolf, who again is an American guy, again TikToker. And again, just going through the videos, and I was like, "Oh god, this is really resonating with me." So went back to the friend that said, "Do you think you could be?" And I was like, "Well, do you think I could? Because I literally am like this, and I listed all this stuff." So there was like, "Yeah, I think you are." And I was like, "So what do I do? Like, what do I do with this information?" Because I was sort of like, I wasn't scared. I was actually thinking, "Oh my god, like this could give me some answers." Like I was a bit like, "You're in a bit of self." Like,
so it's more relief.
Yeah, quite. You're relieved, but also you're still very much like, "Nah, it's not going to be. Nah, they're going to say no." Like, it's just me. I'm just, you know, like sometimes, like when you're looking at things, like, I don't know, maybe you're Googling your symptoms about because you're not well. You think, "Oh, that's all me." But sometimes it really isn't, because you're just like the veering towards that. And I was like, "Oh, maybe they're just going to say it's not." So anyway, she told me what to do, how to do it, and sort of like start the diagnosis. So I did. So I went to the GP, which is sort of quite a fairly straightforward sort of thing. And there is a thing actually that you can do. Like, so with, I don't know whether it's for children, I don't think it is, but sort of for adults, she told me to do this thing called going on the NHS Right to Choose. So it was, I think I've got ADHD.
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah. Have you heard of that?
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah,
so if I'd gone in there normally, I think of ADHD, can you refer me? I would have been put on the normal NHS waiting list, which potentially I think back then was about 2 years, maybe. And then when
3 years it is now, yeah.
It's even longer, yeah. So then when I went back, I said to this, like, I want to use my right to choose on the NHS and choose this particular, I won't say it just because unless I can, we can put it in after maybe, but this particular place. And they was like, "Okay, all right." They literally gave me like this A4 sort of like questionnaire to fill out and then just give back to them, and they wrote off. And that was literally it. So I had to wait. So my initial doctor's appointment was in August 21, And then I got notification that my appointment with them, with these people, was going to be I think September 22. So literally nearly a whole year, or just over a year, sorry, that I was going to wait, which was probably quicker than, it's definitely quicker than the NHS. And so then I was basically waiting. But obviously in between waiting, you're looking at like loads of videos. And thankfully, like a couple of years ago, more and more was coming up, you know, and it's just, it was such a relief to sort of seeing these videos, like, and you're laughing along with some of them, and some of them it's breaking your heart because you're like, oh my God, like, I wish I'd known this years ago. Because you was diagnosed young, wasn't you?
Yeah.
Like, you was really young.
Yeah, I was going to say, in comparison to the way you've seen it, mine was more of a hindrance. Like, I didn't see it as positive or as much as a relief. I kind of saw... But I was very early on. So I got a diagnosis when I was 11. So you're talking like early 2000s. And it was just then, it still was seen just like the naughty kid syndrome. Like, it's just kids that, you know, that were that naughty, that just had that much energy that snapped a diagnosis on. And you were told straight to your face then, you'd just grow out of it. So there was no like coping mechanisms or this is how you deal with it. This is what you've got. This is what you've got to do. It was like, you're basically doing this, like, deal with it. You've got ADHD, take some tablets. And you'll grow out of it. That was kind of the therapy.
Yeah.
So I didn't really look into it, and I resisted it because that's why I was about the personality, because I was thinking, this can't be right. I have to be my own person. How can this be me? Like, everything I do is because this thing. I don't want to be a category. Like, I wanted to be an individual sort of thing, and I didn't realise. It's only till the last three to four years that I've started taking a different approach when I got re-diagnosed as an adult. Of seeing it like you are now, seeing like the relief in it, seeing that everyone's in the same boat and seeing it being positive. Before that, I honestly tell you, it's just a naughty kid, or
I think
someone just saw that as an excuse.
I think as well though, Nate, like when you was diagnosed, say however long ago that was, like years ago, even when this first started coming out, I remember it being quite an American thing and hearing the words like Ritalin, and it was, again, it was the naughty kid thing. It was the stick a tablet in them and sort of almost drug them up to the eyeballs and they're not going to be themselves. I mean, you sort of saw these things in the news, so I didn't really think nothing of it. And definitely, certainly not for girls. I did always think it was literally that, like naughty boys in the classroom who couldn't sit down.
I'm pretty sure they said at one point, it was announced that females couldn't get it. I'm pretty sure really early on that were meant to not be able to catch it,
I mean, years ago, this is how much things have changed with regards to neurodivergence. When my son, who's nearly 21, when sort of like he was very, very young, we were told that the MMR was going to give them autism. That was the link that was made, that obviously now we can look back and laugh and think, oh, my God, how stupid is that? But, like, for us back then, we didn't have the information that we do now. So there was no way that anyone was going to tell me I had something called ADHD and sort of like I could understand it and know that it wasn't just this huge flaw in my personality. It was really hard, growing up.
I can imagine that. Yeah, as I said, at least I knew I had that. It wasn't all doom and gloom, because I did, growing up, I had the, well, not the excuse, I had the reasoning. That, even though it wasn't a very, what reasoning was that back then, I had the reasoning and understanding that I was going to be slightly different. I suppose for you, it would have been awful going from school and stuff, just feeling different, trying, and as being female in itself, having to mask and fit into that social group anyways. How was school?
School... I was always somebody that wanted to be the good girl. Like, I never wanted to not fit in, and sort of like I was quite good in it. Sort of like there were things that I really enjoyed. I picked, this should say how much ADHD I am, because I picked, when you know, like you can have, you can pick a sort of like certain way to go in year 9, I can't remember, options they were called. So I picked drama and art because I was like, I don't want to sit in a classroom. Like, so drama, like I could run around and muck about and like just have a laugh and a joke with my friends. And art, I could literally just get messy and sort of like, and I loved it anyway. So that's the reason sort of that I picked them, and didn't sort of think nothing of it. So I masked really, really, now looking back, obviously I didn't know this at the time, but I masked. I was so distracted. I'd daydream a lot. I used to sit next to somebody and have to sort of say, what did they say? What did they say? Constantly. I mean, I'd done quite well in my exams and stuff. And I did try to go off to college, but just being a teenager and stuff like that, I didn't end up sort of finishing that. But yeah, it wasn't really, I think I didn't notice.
What was discipline like?
What, for me as a child?
Like, just Just in school, what was the discipline like in school, the tolerance in school? Because I'm going to school, and compared to now, I see it strict, but it wasn't at my time. I was always looking back and thinking it was much worse then. How was it? Because I got told all the time, but...
For me, I went to a Roman Catholic school, which was one of the better schools that you could get into then. So it was very strict anyway. I mean, they used to literally measure the height of your heels and the length of your skirt, because we had to adhere to this very specific, you know, uniform. So there was no way on God's earth that I was going to end up in detention and stuff like that. I mean, it was the school was like an old sort of like it used to be like an old nunnery and stuff like that. It was loads of stuff. It was a beautiful building. But when you're in it as a school kid, like, it's scary, especially like the teachers like bellowing down the halls like at you. So to be honest, I was quite good anyway in that sense. You know, I always sort of like kept my, and again, I think a lot of that was masking, because when I look back, I would be funny and have a laugh and a joke, but quite under the radar. Like, I wasn't ever really sort of like outwardly naughty there at all.
Yeah. I think as well, that's a bit of it as well. I don't know how much a strict discipline, or like even going into domestic abuse relationships or upbringings, has an effect on how late the diagnosis of ADHD comes. Because I feel like if you're in, and as you said, but then it's fear, isn't it? It's not just like the normal discipline now when you've kind of got the choice, haven't you? Like, you're going to get punished if you make a mistake. I don't know how much that keeps ADHD in check through fear. And when you've got got that fear, you're kind of, because I've spoke to someone before, and it's got late, like the same as you, female, just got a late diagnosis. But the reason was because she was growing up in domestic abuse relationship, family, went into domestic abuse everywhere. She's in fear of making a step forward. And the last 4 years of her life, when she's been living life, she's realised she's got ADHD. And all of this scattiness has come out of nowhere, she says.
Yeah. I do firmly believe that trauma makes it harder for you to even remotely think of anything to do with anything like that, because that is obviously you, that's a you thing. Mm-hmm. And when you're in survival mode, when you're surviving whatever that is, which is what I was anyway for a very long time, and even sort of growing up, although it wasn't an abusive household like what I grew up in, I very quickly went into very toxic relationships. You know, not all of that was ADHD, some of that was my upbringing and stuff like that. But the problem I found with ADHD, looking back at all of this now, is that with an ADHDer, because we're so open, like, you literally almost give the key to everything that is of value to you, to that person. So you meet somebody.
Yeah, every trigger.
Yeah, literally, like, you literally give them the key. And so your dopamine, when you're saying like, oh, I'm really attracted to this person. And so then you're, you know, like, as you sort of do, you're chatting away and you're just offloading. You're offloading, la, 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 la. And you're telling them everything that you love, that this. So I was a prime target for people to literally mirror back to me. Oh, I love this. Oh, I love that. Didn't occur to me that people like would be horrible. I never had that filter. I never had that safety filter in me. Not once, talking to friends, talking to partners, did I ever think that anyone was going to be horrible to me. And I do think that that's ADHD, because I just believed good. Yeah.
I'm having this. My son's got diagnosed as well, and he'll walk off of anyone. I always joke, like, he wouldn't get kidnapped. He would willingly go. It's that, like, he would, before you know it, he would tell you them address, their everything. Like, anyone could just go to. I'm petrified of him being online. It's only going to take one of them going, go get your mum's debit card and read it out, or something like that, and he's just going to do it. Like, I think you do, until later on in life you realize, then you have the complete opposite. Well, I did anyway, and then I started hating everyone.
Literally.
Because of that pressure.
We don't like people. We've learned. I think as well, it comes from, so the way I've always seen it, like, and again, I'm the same as you in the sense that, so my work, I was only diagnosed at 41, I'm 43 now, and I know that my whole entire life has changed anyway from that diagnosis, because the self-loathing that come with everything, and sort of, why do I do this? Why do I tell people all these things? Why do I share and wear my heart on my sleeve? Why can't I just be, you know, one of these high maintenance girls? I would always be like, you know, and sort of want this and want that. I was just chilled. I was just so like almost like this dozy donut, sort of like, oh, you know, I mean, I'm a nice person anyway, but I think with the ADHD and the way my brain works, like, I'm just like, oh my God, yeah, I love this. I love this too. I love this too. It never occurred to me that anyone might actually be doing something to be vindictive, to be manipulative. It just didn't occur to me. I wouldn't necessarily say as a child, because I think when I was a child, like in the 80s, you had quite a lot of campaigns about stranger danger and stuff like that. So I suppose maybe that's sort of what I would have taken on, and we didn't have the internet back then, back in the dark ages. So like it was a lot easier for people to sort of like sort of just face to face like communication. But I think that the thing with me, like you must have had this conversation again with your friend, like being an ADHD as well, because you're in such self-loathing, because you can't do life, I say, like I could never function how I perceived everybody else functioning, like mothers probably and partners. Like I'd forget so many important things, like and burn the dinner, and like there'd be an important email that I needed to do, didn't do it, or you know, mufti day at the school, constantly forgetting. And I don't, well, I do this, so I don't know whether you do this as a man or a guy. So I do this in the mornings. This is called trying to make the coffee. And I'll explain this to people when they say, I think I might be ADHD. I say, right. So when you get up in the morning, how do you make your coffee? And they go, oh, I'll just put the kettle on and pour it in. And I'm like, okay, so let me tell you how I do it. I said, I get up in the morning, I said, put the cup down. I said, I flick the kettle on. I then go into the bathroom and then pick up the washing, come back in, realise I haven't made the coffee still, go back, flick it on, put the washing in. Then I realise the dog needs feeding. So I'm going to pick up that bowl, come back in, go and sort of like go and get the food. Then it will take me out to do something else. And then I'm making the beds. And I said, this is me trying to make a coffee. I said, 2 hours later, I might actually get a coffee. I said, but it's just because you're going from one thing to the other, because we just can't, our brain doesn't have that ability to prioritize or focus on that one thing. It's very difficult.
Anything, is it? Yeah, I kind of, I've explained it before in a video about like tabs, isn't it? Like everyone can have like, say that people have like computer tabs and like a normal person will have 3 tabs open. And they'll be doing their work. 75% of that tab will be using power on that bit. And then you'll do like the other 20% on saying cows, and maybe 5% on a worry that they're going to go on. Like, but with ADHD, you have 16 tabs and they're all 100%.
Yeah.
And you just skip between the tabs. Like, and every one of the tabs can set you off to the other one. So you could be on one path and then something can set you off and remind you of something on another one. So you quickly dart to the other one, drop what you're doing. It's just constant. Do you know, it's like repetitive amnesia.
Yeah. It's really like I don't
know. Constant amnesia.
Yeah, and don't get me wrong. I mean, I do make sort of like light of most of it most of the time, but there is a very dark side to it, you know, like whether I think you're male or female or however you present, I think there is a really, really dark side to it because, you know, people who don't have it or don't know nothing about it think, oh, well, it's just a bit, you can't focus. And I'm like, well, no, actually, it comes into more than that. Like, you know, you have to make sure that you inform the DVLA as well if you have a diagnosis, you know, because that can potentially cause problems. There's so much to it. Like, and going to the cinema, like other people can go to the cinema and watch a film for 2 hours. I can if I'm really interested. And
really
if
interested. Yeah.
I'm not, if there's not a lot of people in the cinema, I can usually sit there. But I'm literally like this in my seat. I can't sit still. There is no sitting still. I'm constantly moving. Do you get the leg shake where you're sitting there and my leg's doing it now, like
constant?
Yeah.
And do you know what I hate as well? Yeah. So I used to go out as well. I used to drink as well. So I used to do it on the night out and people would come up to me and like tap me on the shoulder and be like, sorry, mate, you don't need to be nervous. I used to go mad. Like, what?
Yeah.
Like,
what nervous?
I'm not scared. I don't want people to think that I'm just sitting here shaking for my life in here. Is that what it looks like? And and then you can't stop it. And you feel like a crackhead almost. You're like, oh, my God. Like,
yeah, literally. I mean, before you had all this information about it, like, I hadn't even noticed it, if I'm honest. I never even noticed it. But now that you're aware, like, I'll be sitting there and I'll be doing it. So, like, when I go to the gym, so I'm, you know, like you're sitting and resting in between sets. So if I usually dance, to be honest, in between my sets. Like I don't care anymore. I'm just like raving, and it's another good expenditure of energy. So I'm literally like hardcore raving. But I look around, and the amount of people, both male and female, that I can see sitting like on their machines, their legs like this, and I'm like, I know that that's not just them sort of like tapping. It's literally the ADHD shake, and I'm like, no, there's another one. And it's one of them things that unless somebody sort of says anything to me about, you know, do you think I could be ADHD? I never sort of try and sort of say anything like that unless I see them like hating on themselves. That's the thing. I don't know whether you know this.
That's the realness of it, isn't it? It's the sadness. It's turned into a bit of a fashion statement, isn't it? But that's how you tell the difference, is the rawness of your life has been a mess. You're slightly depressed. There is certain hope that's lost in you. Like, especially if you're undiagnosed, the longer you are going that, you'll have that. And you can't just be like all these people going on that, oh yeah, I've got that, like I forget things all the time. Like, you're too happy. Like, I know it sounds mad, but you are too happy. Like, your life is too, like, there is a couple, I'm not going to name who it is, but they drive me absolutely mad on TikTok. One of them's meant to be like autistic, one of them's meant to have ADHD. They are the most normalist looking family I've seen in my life. And it's just like, she says stuff like, oh, so I'm going to do this, and this is when I'm stimming. I'm like, you're not even doing it in the video. So how are you even doing it? How have you managed to compose yourself through all this thing? Nothing's scattered in your life. Everything's organized, and you delivered a message of organization, and you're trying to preach ADHD. That's the wrong message. You need to be real, don't you? You have to be real. It's life is shit. You can't go day to day. You've got, like, keeping on top of cleaning your house is a massive task. And even not being able to do that is step one. I don't fit in. I can't do this. Why can't I live life?
It's the fitting in. That's exactly what it is. And it's how society puts us, like, and in our boxes, like male, female, you know, sort of like, and our energies and stuff like that, and sort of the jobs and the roles that we're supposed to sort of like do, you know, the mother role, the tidier. Don't get me wrong, it is getting better. Yeah. And thank God that we're sort of all breaking out of these things. And I don't think anyone should belong in any box. But it was those things that I remember, even in that abusive relationship, like I would be being made really awful, like being made to feel really awful, because how I just said to you about the coffee thing, about sort of getting distracted, I would clean the house, and I mean I would not sit down all day, and I mean all day, and this is something I don't do. I generally do not sit down to relax, as in like sitting on the sofa, until I know that I'm not going to be doing anything else, because my ADHD brain can't relax anyway. But I would be always made to feel so awful for, you know, oh well, you don't do it like this, and this is how isn't how I like it, and so then you've got these other people like perpetuating this hate on you as well, and these judgments on you. And well, you know, I mean, I was told by somebody close to me, you know, even about the abusive relationships, well, you did get in the relationships with them, you know, which, you know, what did you expect? And it's things like that where you have got so much self-hate anyway that literally you're like, oh my god. And I don't know whether you know much about the whole rejection sensitivity dysphoria. Do you know anything?
I'm not as bad. I'm not as bad. Now I know a lot about it. Yeah. As I said, I've been managing it for a long sort of time, so I've kind of got over it. But I was, as a kid, couldn't take it. Like, if you just the slightest bit of, oh, you don't want to play with you, or I want to play with someone else, I was ready to fight them there and then.
Gut-wrenching. Yeah, it's gut-wrenching. And this is the thing. Yeah. Like not fitting into society, like, the whole thing, like, I think as a woman, as a parent, like, however you identify, if you're not sort of almost in your box, you can feel really like a letdown to whoever you've got around you, to society. Like, what am I doing here? And I know that before I was diagnosed, my mental health was literally in the toilet. I mean, granted, I had literally come out of a very abusive relationship. I was going through all of that. It was COVID. It was really horrific. That's another whole episode in itself. But literally, like, to sort of finally have someone say, do you think you could be? And then it was like these light bulb moments going off in my head. And I was like, when I actually finally got diagnosed, it was like via Zoom, obviously, again, COVID. And so I actually got it slightly earlier, because my mental health was so bad, I'd actually emailed the place that was doing my diagnosis, said, have you got any sooner appointments? And I was, you know, thank you know, the universe that they did. So in May of 2022, so I'm sitting in front of this sort of doctor who's on there. You do get like information that you have to fill in as well. Like, they'll ask you like questions and stuff like that. So once you do all that, send it off to them, then you have this appointment. So I'm sitting there, and again, I'm sort of doing this and fidgeting in my seat, and he's asking me a few questions. He wasn't even really looking at me that much. He was just like, And then, I'm not joking, in about 20 minutes, 25 minutes, it was, yes, you've got 9 out of 9 for inattentiveness and 9 out of 12 for the other. And again, ADHD can never remember how they like sort of do it on the structure of it. And he was like, so yeah, that's fine. And he was like sort of writing notes. And I went, does that mean I've got ADHD then? He went, oh yeah. And it was like,
oh, you got, I didn't realize. I thought that was just me. They're so light with diagnosis. You get all the way there and they just go, yeah, you got it. And then you walk out and you're like, I was expecting, like, I don't know what I was expecting, but I was expecting more than this. Like, information. Don't send me home with this diagnosis. Like, just like that. Like,
yes, you've got it. Bye. And I was just like, oh, okay. And then you sort of like, so then you'd been telling people, oh, I'm going for a diagnosis. I'm going for a diagnosis. And then you get the, yeah, you've got it. So then you're a bit like, yeah, I've got it, apparently. Like, you know. I don't know what I'm supposed to do. And that's what people say to you. So what do you do now? And I'm like, I don't know. And so they asked me, did I want to start medication? And I thought, well, in for a penny, in for a pound. You know, in my ADHD days, that, well, obviously I am anyway, but back in like my youth, I mean, I tried every drug going. So I thought I might as well try these. You know, this can help me, you know.
This might be all right. This actually might actually, I'll take it.
Rather than being in the destructive drinking and drugs and stuff and like trying to sort of calm my mind, I sort of thought, yeah, I'll go for that. They put me on this tritation and I take medication for it now. But that was another big thing. I remember sort of looking back at my life, sort of like I got the medication, but when I sort of sat there and I was going through this thing in my head that I'd been given this diagnosis and I was looking back at my life and thinking, ah, that's why, like, I could never, like, so people go out for a drink. I was like, what do you mean a drink? Like, and I was like, and so literally I was like, I'm going to drink till I'm drunk.
Impossible.
Yeah.
Impossible.
Like, yeah. Who's going out for one? Like, what? Like, don't swear at me. And like, I mean, don't get me wrong. Not, again, it was very, very destructive behaviour. Some of that was to do with the situations that I was in and things like that as well and reactions to that. But I now understand that the actual consumption of the alcohol and the drugs wasn't because I wanted to party hard. It was because I just wanted to get out of my own head because it was always so busy. And this is what I never understood until I got the diagnosis. So I would take cocaine, right, back in my youth. And so other people, when they took it, so we'd be out drinking, you know, partying hard. People then would be quite happy they'd do it and they'd go off really partying. It didn't make me do that. It literally, like, I would take it and then I'd be like, I could literally reorganise my entire wardrobe right now and actually colour coordinate it. And
complete opposite effects.
it was literally this, like, and my mind went quiet and I felt like almost, I don't know, it was just this weird sensation. But because, like, you'd had a drink and because obviously it's blooming illegal and stuff like that, you're not really thinking of it. And I never really vocalized it because I didn't know how anyone was supposed to feel taking it. And then when I realized in my diagnosis, when they said about the medication that you take is like the only way I can describe it, I mean, I don't even know what the medical name is, but it's speed. That's essentially what it is.
Amphetamine makeup, isn't it? You have two types, of stimulants and a non-stimulants. The stimulants are the amphetamine.
Yeah, and I was just like, what do you mean? And again, I had to look into it and I was a bit like, oh, okay. And when they sort of said controlled drug, again, like, I was 41. I was like, what do you mean? Like, I don't understand. So again, looking into it, I was like, they treat like ADHD with that type of drug because, say, like, somebody explained it to me once like this. So here's normal people, right? They take cocaine, they're here, right? But we're here, and that's why we come here, because our brains come down and calm down. And it's things even like caffeine and like Red Bulls and things like that. People would take them and be out partying. I could go home and go to bed. And it just...
Yeah, because it mutes. We don't get... So with caffeine, I'm not too sure about the cocaine, because I was on cocaine for ages as well, but... With the caffeine, I know it's because, you know, the energy bursts and stuff that they get to our body, so they get a physical reaction to it too. We don't get the physical reactions. We only get the sharpness of the mind, which would be like, and to us, that calms it down. As I said, like, relaxes it. Where to them, it will wake it up and make it active. That kind of gives us a stimulant. It stimulates our minds. It gives us what we need to stimulate ourselves, but it doesn't give us the body effect, which is why we can go to sleep and stuff after.
I think, like, I don't know whether for you, although you had the diagnosis, you didn't really, again, have loads of information about it like we do now. And obviously I didn't, and was like, when I say winging it through life, that is the understatement of the century. But when I look back now with the information, I'm like, oh, there's so many moments where I'm like, oh my God, like, yes, I remember that. Oh, like, and I totally get as well. Like, so it's like when, like, we've talked about, like being in the abusive relationships and stuff like that. And sort of obviously you can't prioritize yourself. So you're in survival mode. So that's, you're not even thinking about anything other than just living and surviving. And then when I look back as well, and I look back how I fell into these relationships, and saying at the beginning, you know, sort of like offloading all this information, giving the key to myself to these people, and where you're so self-loathing and stuff like that, I think comes hand in hand. When your brain is not wired to how society and neurotypical people are, so you're automatically sort of like not the right footing as these people, you know. And so you're always sort of thinking, oh, why can't I do this? Why can't I do this? So then I think, and again, it's not self-blame either, but I think the reason I stayed as well for so long is because I kept trying to make sense of, like, so apart from obviously being gaslit and stuff, but then because your memory's not particularly great as an ADHDer, I kept thinking, but is it me? Like, you're questioning yourself. So I think on top of all of the abuse that was going on, you're in this internal battle with, so did I remember that right? Is this right? I mean, obviously that's horrific in itself because being gaslit and stuff like that, but you're still like, oh, I don't know whether I remember it right. And, you know, what happened? Do you know what I mean? There's so much more to where you're so
full of self-loathing.
Like, and I'm not saying that people that aren't sort of neurodivergent aren't like that. I know that there's an element of that. And not everybody that's been in an abusive relationship, of course, they're not neurodivergent. But I just think
they're not told constantly, though. They're not told, are they? They're not told, stop doing this, stop singing this, why are you doing this? Why are you wearing this? Why can't you remember that? Why can't you do this? This is the thing they miss. They don't get told that daily.
No.
Like, so that's like we do. Like, I mean, we have got so sensitive to it. We're beaten by it. When I kind of went through it, I switched very quickly, and fingers crossed, I was angry. I hated people for ages because I was like, why, you lot just keep telling me off. Like, I don't understand. I can't help it. I just cut myself off, really. Mm. And I'm glad that I had a diagnosis, because if I didn't, like you didn't, I think I would have just been that weirdo. You know, that weirdo that just kind of like, you don't know what he's acting. You don't know when he's going to get mad. He's sort of funny sometimes. Sometimes he's not in the mood. Like, just that random, like, it's America, like school shooter or something. Do you know what I mean?
Just so unpredictable. Yeah. This is, I think, like, and I don't think it's easy for either sort of like female or male. And again, I don't think it's easy for either in how it presents itself. And what's strange is that I actually knew a trans woman, and obviously so from male to female. And when we were talking about it, they were diagnosed and they presented in a female way. And it's a really, like, I found it so interesting to sort of,
quite interesting,
yeah, to ask questions like, oh wow,
yeah,
like,
that's really, you know, interesting,
completely not how the atypical male presented, and she presented before she transitioned but in a female way, and it was only after that then she found out. And it's really strange, I think, how you've got like the different I wouldn't say that I think it's easier for you at all, because I think it's not easy at all. But part of me wishes that we could be the loud, the throwing the chairs, that so that someone would notice,
much more easily identifiable, isn't it? I said it's kind of the silent killer for females,
yeah,
where it's kind of very obvious for a male. They're trying to struggle, isn't it? As I said, a lot of my frustrations were taken out just being a guy, just getting, you know, physical fights, just being destructive in class, you know, arguing. But you, I suppose, as well, females, it comes across a lot more inattentive, doesn't it? It's
huge.
Again, like the housework and stuff like that, not being able to keep up, the cooking, the, you know, just doing a daily thing. I mean, just like doing your nail appointment, your eyelashes and your makeup every day is a challenge. I always think that I'm glad that I'm male, because I would not be a good female. I can't do it. Forget it. Every day.
Yeah. It's, don't get me wrong. Like, again, going back to like appointments and stuff like that, sort of like, before I knew, and when I was sort of like with the abuser and stuff like that, again, a lot of things weren't as they are now, like as in through the email. So a lot of it still would be letters, like literally physical letters that you'd get from the school, from doctors, whatever, to go for these appointments. Mm-hmm. I could have it pinned on the fridge that I would open every single day quite regularly. La, da, 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 and it doesn't matter because I'm not seeing it. I'm not actually seeing it. Like, it's not registering in me. And like, I literally have been handed something that's so important, and unless I keep it there and phone that person or do something immediately, it just as if it didn't exist. And
do you know, it's, it, It, you know, it's like, you know, video camera. I've always explained it like this. You know, like when you go to video something before you press record. Yeah. That's like the ADHD brain. It might be on all the time. It might be looking like it's going there, but it's not always recording. So it's, as you said about the picture, it might be on the wall, but it's not registering in my head. Or I might be having a conversation with you, but I'm not actually listening. It's not going in. So sometimes the record button comes on and off, like throughout the day.
Yeah, the amount of times as well, as an ADHD, I mean, you must have had this thousands of times. I know I have, that you're chatting to somebody and it might generally be, I mean, it could be someone, you know, regularly. It could be in a wedding. It could be anywhere, but you're sitting there talking and you really are listening to begin with. And then something happens like out of it, like out of your sight. So you can hear it. And then you're like, your brain sort of like, a visual way would be like you're like that, like you've sort of gone off, like, so you're looking dead, you know, in the eyes. Yeah. And you're thinking, you're nodding, doing all the thing, and you're listening to that, or the kids that are screaming, or, you know, someone getting told off, or the row that's going on behind you, or whatever it is. It doesn't matter what it is. It's just your brain's decided to completely log out of whoever you're talking to, and you're still like doing this.
It's so rude, isn't it? But
literally, I mean, before I was diagnosed as well, like, again, masking, I used to mask all the time, right? But now, like, if I'm with, I mean, to be honest, I don't know whether you've got this as well, but now my circle, I think, if I think about, and I've got a very close-knit circle, I think we all are ADHD women, literally, all of us. And I've navigated naturally towards.
I would say mine's, they're going to hate me, but they're definitely autistic, all of my friends. I'm telling you, I don't know what I've done to deserve this in life, to be with ADHD and with people that are completely out of my pace. Like, do you know what I mean? I try to raise something. Yeah. I'm just like, yeah, let's go do it. They're like, no, nope, yeah. 2 weeks practice. We need to research every single bit of it. This needs to happen now. I'm like, oh my God.
Yeah. You need some ADHD, isn't it? Yeah. You need some ADHDs in your life because literally, like, sometimes it can be like, so some of my friends, I've got one friend and she's literally, I mean, obviously, I don't know exactly, but I always say 50-50 ADHD and autistic. And we're great. We can organize something last minute, maybe sort of like, in 2 days' time, or we'll arrange something. But if we're going out like for lunch or something, she'll know what's on that menu first and sort of like doing it that way. But a lot of the friends that I have now, we are much more spontaneous and it's very much like, do you want a coffee today? And don't get me wrong, not too much, not like loads in advance or even sort of like too late either. But I've navigated naturally towards these people. And I'm not joking. Yeah. Sort of who I am as well as a person. Sort of like I'll start chatting to anyone, I mean, I'll be in anywhere shopping, like, you know, Primark, wherever. And if someone catches my eye and I don't know, that maybe they'll sigh or huff or whatever. And I like to sort of make people feel better. And I always try to sort of like chat to them. And the amount of times that my kids are literally just rolling their eyes, like, why do you have to talk to everyone, Mum? Like, why? And I'm like, well, you know, like, they might be having a bad day. Like, let's just not have a chat. But I do think that's my ADHD in me. And I don't know whether you get
We're not scared of social situations. No, yeah, I think you're not. I'm very confident. And even like, considering that the way we're talking to like today, people think that maybe we've known each other for ages. We haven't. As I said, we've only known each other a couple of weeks over Instagram, a few messages here and there, but we're having some conversation. But that's the ADHD, to come on to podcast and be confident, not have anything rehearsed. I've not written anything down. I've got like prompts of something, but then I know it's going to work. And that's our superpowers. It's not all doing stuff, but the confidence. I'm not scared to talk to no one. And I think sometimes if it's a really someone's, if everyone's like, especially at work, I was like this before. I was like a registered manager, I was a support worker. You know that I'm going to say something. You know, I was always the guy. They'd send me, go do it. I'd be And the more dangerous it was to say, I'd say it. But then I'd always turn around and everyone would be like, don't know what he's talking about. Don't know what he's doing. Don't know why he said that. Like, what?
As if you've been pushed forward, like, and then everyone else is sort of like hiding backwards, and you're like, you know, I'm exactly the same, like literally. So after like hand in hand with like sort of finding out the diagnosis, I've done a lot of work like on myself, like from the trauma and stuff like that. So talk therapy, go to the gym. I'm sober. I gave up drinking completely. I'm nearly 2 years sober now. I know you're sober as well, aren't you? And like everything, you don't touch anything, do you?
Yeah, look at us all sober and that. Like, do you know what I mean? We're ADHD changing the stigma around ADHD. Yeah.
And this is the thing. I honestly used to believe, oh my God, like I can't do this. Like I'm totally like an alcoholic and I'm addicted and I can't do this without help and I'm going to have to go to like the Priory. I honestly, hand on my heart, genuinely believed I would have to go in for help. I was even phoning people up. And it got to the point where I'd sort of stopped for a few weeks and then carried on, stopped for again. I've done it on and off over anyway the last few years, even sort of when I was with the abuser. I kept trying because I knew it just wasn't making me feel good. But literally, I got to a point like 2 years ago on the 8th of April. We'd just moved and I literally woke up and thought, I don't want to feel like this anymore. That's it, I'm done. So I decided to stop. And then I was counting the days and things like that. And again, I never believed for one moment that I was going to carry on. I just kept taking day by day. I didn't go and didn't feel the need to go to like AA, or I didn't need any help from anyone, or I literally just stopped. And so that was literally, and I come up, my 2 year anniversary is like next month. So
brilliant.
Yeah, it's. I mean,
what is it? What's your main? Is it alcohol your main?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I never really done anything else without drinking first. I would never choose to
drink at the root.
It was always alcohol because alcohol gave me the buzz like that. Oh yeah, come on, one sip of a drink, and I mean literally a sip of a drink. I would be like, let's go to this place. And I don't think I was ever particularly a horrible person. I'm not saying there wasn't times that maybe obviously that was the case, but I was always probably the most annoying person because I would want to be like, come on, let's go, let's have some fun. And as I got older, that obviously that less and less going out, because obviously we hate people. You're sort of at home and stuff like that. And I just thought, why am I doing this? And again, this all did come hand in hand, like with like the work I'd done on myself from leaving like the trauma and that. And there was a lot of work. And for me, just to stop, it was quite shocking for me being an ADHDer because of our addictive nature. Like we are, I think somebody that actually invented Pringles was an ADHDer. Once you pop, you can't stop. Like I really do think, because it is literally in our nature to just want and have. You know, and it was never that I intended
to. It's a bucket that never gets filled, isn't it?
Exactly. Like people, when we were out drinking, even when I was just having fun, I was having three to every one of theirs because I was bang, bang, bang. I don't mean shots, I mean drinks, because I was just like, riding this dopamine wave, like, woohoo, you know, and I never really understood it. And so for me, as I sort of like came out of all of that and I was like going through loads and loads of stuff like to do with the abuse and that, and I thought, oh, I just don't want to, the alcohol was starting to really, really affect me in such a negative way for such a long time anyway. And again, it was, I was sort of going to sleep like really, really early, just not really being present, constantly feeling a bit crap. And then I gave it up, but I was so shocked that I didn't need help. And not that there's any shame in that either, but I just thought, I could never do this. Like I never had that self-belief.
Yeah, that's weird. Yeah, because that's exactly how I done it. So I was a bit different. So I had a spontaneous baby. Little heart, Maria. Yeah. So basically, that was the end of the line for me. I was like, I'm done. So I literally got the news. So it's basically obviously going out, getting drunk as you do, and then like didn't know, it was one night stands. Didn't know, they thought it was someone else's. Then it turned out it wasn't theirs, and then obviously then it looked back and thought, oh, it might be his. Turned out it was, and I was thinking, oh shit, and then something inside me just clicked. And I remember at the time I got told as well, I had a ticket and I had just a fresh one, yeah, I had it on the plate, just lined up as well, you know, that's the best bit, just pressing it like the night's gonna be good, I've got endless amount of it,
yeah,
over. And then I thought, and I just remember coming down, picking it up and just throwing it in the garden. And I remember, anybody that does cocaine knows how mad that is.
Yeah.
Like, you would never do that. Like, people nearly get beaten up for knocking drinks over plates. Like,
yeah.
So I just threw it and I've never looked back. Never looked back. I've got a kid. At the end of the day, so my overdrive has gone into it. I'm like, I knew I would have 2 to 3 to 4 to 5. Like, and it would just be, I know, because I see them all and I'm very active in their life.
Yeah.
It was more of like, I can't have another one on top of this in my life. I'm going to have no life left. Like, if it was like I was going to have them and like not have anything to do with them, might be more likely. But it was just like, oh God.
Yeah.
I just got through cold turkey. Probably the worst thing I've done, because it really, really affected me.
Yeah.
It hurt though. Like, from that to nothing and 3 months of hell.
Yeah. I bet. I mean, probably medically, like I would say that probably wasn't like.
Yeah.
The healthiest way to do it. And although my body wasn't physically addicted to it, like, and again, I mean this with no shade or no shame to anyone else, but I was one of the wine culture drinkers, you know, who, you know, unfortunately that's perpetuated through society. And it's sort of like, so it was more acceptable to sort of like have, you know, once you came in, like I used to have this thing, like for my kids. I mean, I'm laughing, but it's really not funny. But I'd always say to them, sort of like, right, so I'd come home, like school runs, da 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 da, this is like before, and get their dinners done, all the rest of it. And I was waiting for the time I could start drinking, just waiting. And now obviously I'm drinking for very many reasons, you know, for at that point as well. But I always used to say, right, you know what time it is, don't you, kids? And they'd be like, yep, mummy's taking her bra off. Yep, mummy's taking her bra off. So that means that mummy's not doing anything else now. And I'd literally, bath time was done, everything was done. So that was like my signal, and like the laughing and joking about it. And it was so acceptable, you know, to do it. You know, I mean, again, this goes into so many different other things, but sort of with the ADHD, when I sort of come back to the whole, I really honestly believe that I could never, ever, ever, ever stop. I was so surprised. And I can hand on my heart genuinely now say I don't even think about it. I mean, I don't really go into pubs anyway, but I literally don't even think about drinking. I don't think about it when I'm in the shop. I don't miss.
Have you replaced it, do you think, with anything, like, because you go to gym and stuff now, don't you? Do you think that's quite taken over? I feel like with ADHD, you have to be addicted to something. This is just my latest craze. This might not work out. I could be doing this for a month and shut down. You don't know.
Yeah. Late type of focusing on this one at the moment. Yeah.
That's it. Yeah,
I do. I think you need something. You need a dopamine fix. So when you're doing loads of work on yourself anyway, and you're sort of looking at the thing. So again, there was a lot of reasoning behind. I could understand how I ended up in the abusive relationships. And again, not to self-blame, it was just understanding. And then you understand why I drank so much, why I did this, why I went there. And then you look back, and again, a lot of my stuff came from, you know, toxic parents, childhood. It wasn't this horrific one, but I understand where my problems were coming from. So I did all of this work, and so I needed something for dopamine, and I started the gym literally 2 years, about the same time I gave up drinking, actually, because I thought, for that reason, right, if I'm not doing drinking, I need something to sort of like, not just going, so I'd go, and I knew that I couldn't be there all bloody day, but also then, you know, when you're on your TikToks and your Instagram, so I needed something to look at. So I thought I'd go into looking into the gym's programs and bits and pieces, just our ideas, TikToks and that. So yeah, I started the gym and I found that I really loved it. And again, I did sort of wait around for the dopamine to sort of wear off, if I'm honest. I thought it might, but it's just got better, because apart from the fact
that you get cleaner, don't you? Healthier.
Yeah. It goes hand in hand with everything. And like, so I was not drinking anyway. And so that made me feel better. And physically, I was feeling so much better anyway. So then you're doing all this other stuff, and with the gym, you're learning like new things. And, you know, like, I know that there's maybe a bit of a culture where people think it's a competition against each other. It's not, it's about yourself. So I was literally like learning how to move my body, what worked, what didn't work, you know, what I liked, what I didn't like. And so I've been going like solidly now for 2 years, and it's changed my life. It's really, 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 there's so many things that I can say positively about the gym. And you do have to be really careful as an ADHD to not get it in the addictive cycle though. So
yeah, I've seen a couple of people go that way. Literally just eat and prey on powder.
Yep. Literally, you should replace cocaine for protein powder. So yeah. And it's like, literally, apart from the fact you're putting it in your milkshake instead. But instead of that, I knew that I had to be really careful. So to begin with, I made sure 3 days a week. So it was just 3 days. And that's what I did for a very long time, actually, for about a year. And with that, sort of a couple of times I worked with some PTs just to get an idea. But I knew that I wanted to do it on my own. I made the very conscious choice as well to start that journey on my own, not to go with anyone. And that was my personal preference, because I didn't ever want to rely on anybody. Because I thought, if I relied on this person, that friend, and then they started not going, I'd then be like, oh, I won't go then. So I knew I had to just be really disciplined with myself. And, you know, of course, there were times where I didn't go, and, you know, do you know what I mean? Of course. But what I found as well, it was doing, I remember literally saying to one of my PTs when it was about a year in, and I'd moved back into sort of like where I am now. And I was saying to this PT, and I was just, I'd felt rubbish sort of before. And I remember after I'd worked out, I looked at her and I was like, why don't they like provide this on prescription? Why don't they tell people to come into the gym to just feel better in their head? And she was like, I know. She said, it's like, and I also told her that she was an ADHD as well, by the way. But it just, it's changed my life. It really has changed my life massively.
I vouch. Yeah. I don't go as much as you do, but I do know, I know when to go, if that makes a difference. Mm-hmm. So I've got a yearly membership. I go through waves and I do get the dopamine, but I'm just, I said, I get distracted with doing stuff and TikTok and that. So I it's all right. But when you do go, and I've noticed that there is a point, I don't think I could get through life. I couldn't go for a year now. Sometimes I couldn't go to the gym for a year. I think I'll probably start losing my shit. Like, it's what, something with the stress would build up at some point too much and it'll start bubbling out. But since I've been going, it's changed, as I said. Yeah, I know now if I just have 5 days to go to the gym, come back, you're too tired to do anything else.
Yeah.
Just can't move.
Yeah, that's the thing, like, especially on leg day, Jesus. But that's what I found as well. Like, so again, hand in hand with all this, I was doing all this other work as well, and sort of like in talk therapy, I was sober and, you know, building my own self-esteem up, you know, because you have to really understand. Mm. I really needed, for me personally, to understand the basics of ADHD. What is it? Why, for me, how do I present in it? So this is how I presented. And I knew that my self-loathing came from a lot of from that and not being able to do this, this and this. So I knew that I needed to understand it so I could accept it and then be like, okay, so what can I do? And I knew that as much as you've got all the negatives, like how artistic, funnily enough, not autistic, but artistic I am, and how, as much as I do interrupt people and I do talk like a million miles an hour, like I'm on drugs, you would think sometimes that I am on drugs because I'm like, blah, blah, blah. But, you know, I know that I'm a really kind person with it. I know that I want to help people. And I find that that's really helpful.
Yeah, that's not spoken about enough, is it? The positivity of ADHD. Like, as much as doom and gloom, there is, and I'm guilty for it too, because I do go on the dark side, and it is hard when you're as depressed and beaten as you are with ADHD, but there is some things we can do that I can't explain, and I know that no one else can do it. Like, when you hyper-focus on Sega, when we want to learn something, that information is going in rapid. Like, you can learn, like, nearly a new skill in a day if you've got ADHD and you really wanted to do it. Or even just balancing up, like, part of my job as register manager, some of the things I pull off, not saying that I'm great management, there's a lot of it that's not great for ADHD, but some of the great bit is great, is I've got like 7 homes. So I can sort of like, and it doesn't bore me. So I could do a bit in here, bit in here, bit in here, bit in here. So in the day, I'll just go through all the homes sort of thing. And I know that some people, that they don't like that. They want to sit down and focus. I love it. I'll just like throw myself in. But when I have to do something serious and sit down in the office for a day, I get really, really annoyed. I don't like it.
Oh, that's painful.
They shut me in doing paperwork. But,
so painful. This but is the
there
thing.
There is positives.
Huge. There is a lot. And this is, I'm someone that's always half glass full anyway. Yes, there is really huge negatives. But for me, like, we're fantastic in a chaos, in a crisis, like literally, like anyone else, like, if there's, I don't know, if someone, God forbid, but someone gets run over outside, move out of the way. I might not be a medical professional, but I can organise the road, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, literally, like, there's so much
of it in me.
But like you say, if it's like quiet and being quiet and having to be reserved and that, I can't do that very well. You know, that is something that I know. But so that's, again, in the gym, like, people maybe think, I sort of thought, maybe people think that, you know, I think that I'm all that, and I really don't. I just don't give any fucks anymore. I'm just like, this is me.
Yeah.
And I'm bopping away to myself and doing what I need to do in the gym and sort of like how that's helped my brain. And honestly, I would say to anyone, and again, I know this goes hand in hand with my trauma and stuff, but sort of for me, it was the offloading at talk therapy. Then it was the gym, the physical stuff, getting that out, going on walks and stuff. And then you'll find, like, your thing, obviously, is like doing your TikToks and sort of like doing all of like the podcasts and stuff that you're doing. For me, music. Music's a huge part of my life. Like, I've always got my headphones.
Oh, yeah. I used to be doing music, actually.
Yeah, and it's just, I love it. And sort of having headphones on, going for a walk, you know, sort of doing things for yourself, filling your own cup, understanding what makes you tick as well. Because we were so, so busy masking, a lot of us, and however you presented, you're so busy masking. Do you know if you like that dinner? Do you know if you like that show? Do you know if you like doing that thing? And you have to really understand.
Yeah, that's so true. That's so true. Yeah. I think, again, you just normalize what everyone has normalized. Like, you just go along with the crowd, didn't you? Then you don't stop to think, do I actually like that, or do I actually want to do that, or am I just doing it because everyone else is going out and doing this? Like,
And sort of, and again, I mean, although I do sort of think a lot of this comes down to our ADHD, it does come to other things as well, about your upbringing, about your circle, about how you feel about yourself. And what I sort of tended to find, like, you know, like, doing sort of like quiet things and things, I do struggle with things like that. But if it was something like, I don't know, say like, although I struggle with quiet, if I went in to do painting pottery, for example, if I liked it, I could probably do that for an hour. Probably that's about it, but then I could do that. And then it's about finding what your niche is, finding what floats your boat and not being ashamed of that. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? Like, there's no shame
it's
in any
confidence.
Of it.
It's just, yeah. My discovery the last few years has been coming out of that masking seat. So obviously I wouldn't have had to do it as much, but you still do kind of like, as I said, what I really wanted to do was out of sync. I was going out partying to that, wearing tracksuit and stuff like that. Like, I really like weird stuff, like, you know, like medieval stuff and that. Like,
yeah.
But what I found out recently is coming, I don't know if that's just something when, as I said, it gets hard because I'm 30 or 40, like, so coming into it. But it's part of adult ADHD, I think, that you separate from, I think, as when you're younger, you kind of, you have to do that, don't you? Then there's a point, you know, your friendship groups go down, you know, you've only got so many friends. You then have to confront yourself, don't you? And have to be like, wow. And I think every time going into an adult ADHD, you reset yourself again. I think you have a whole child knows ADHD. Then as an adult, it's a completely different diagnosis and completely different set of problems. Like, it's a complete reset. Anyone that thinks that it's following, because you can't really, as a kid, you can run around all the time and be naughty and sort of thing, just get away with it, answer back sort of thing. As an adult, you can't be doing it. You get fired at the end of the day, innit? Yeah. Like, if you answer back to your boss, you're gone. Like, you can't, you have to really manage it. And then it comes out more in depression, more into suppression and all of that sort of stuff. So I think it's, I think adult ADHD needs to be looked at separately.
I don't think as well that any of us are saying that we want this huge, like these huge margins made for us. Not at all, not at all. But it's more, if people understood more that it isn't just forgetting a few things and you're really struggling to, you know, and again, you could have a period where, you know, you're having a really good time, but then you'll get burnout, you know. So as a kid, again, burnout, you wouldn't necessarily recognise maybe with a bit of naughty behaviour. But as an adult, I know that if I'm having, I know this is how the pattern goes with me. I'm doing really, really good. I'm having a great time. And then I almost have this great, fantastic time. And then literally the pattern's always been crash straight away every single time. Yeah. And now that, and I used to really, again, I'd hate myself for it. What, you know this, Nicola, why are you stressing about this? Why are you tearing your hair out and crying and on the bathroom floor? And you know why? Because you've had this. And I, again, before, logically, I can recognize it. I know it's there, it's going to come. But then emotionally, that doesn't matter. My emotional brain's like, yeah, well, you know, we just want to like, cry and just think that everything's going to, that the world's going to end. And sometimes you're battling your logical brain and your emotional brain quite a lot. But I do understand and now know how to use my self-care in a way that if I really am feeling a bit like burned out, I know if I need to be around people or not, or do I need to sort of like do it? And usually, I don't know about you, but I mean, for me, before I knew and all the rest of it, that could be days and days where I'd need to be alone or days and days where I'd need to be out. Whereas now I manage it much better because I'm so more understanding of it. So I'm literally like, oh, okay. Yeah. Like, so I'm feeling like this. What does this mean? This means probably maybe I need some time out, or this means that maybe coffee.
I think it's a combination, isn't it, of acceptance. I think a lot of the time I was running away from it, like, nope, this ain't me. When you accept it, that's the first stage. And the second stage is, like you're saying, isn't it, just kind of getting into managing it, understanding it, is where you're going to, you know, it's not going to go away. That's the thing that you've got to kind of get your head around. And I think that especially when, because I thought it was going to go as adulthood, and I got the shock of my life and I got re-diagnosed worse as an adult. But then I don't know, it's a hard one, isn't it? The more understanding you have of it, the easier it makes it, but it doesn't stop it. If that makes sense, isn't it? Yeah. Like, you still will always go through the process. You just will get better at managing it.
Did you ever see the, and again, we'd have to look at the data on this, where we get it. But I remember reading quite a few times about how an ADHD brain doesn't fully form until you're nearly 30. So you're not fully like, do you know what I mean? Like, although your brain's formed, sorry, but like
your emotional age is not catched up. Yeah.
Yeah. And so when I look back and, what I do also believe, and this is my personal belief, not something I've read, but I do believe that trauma makes things a lot worse in the sense of your symptoms. Like, although like you're masking after that, the brain sort of fog, the things like that, obviously that's now intertwined with your ADHD. So you've got to sort of like try and almost manage that side of things as well. I'm managing, so am I healing my trauma and things like this, or is this just part of me? And then you have to really differentiate what is it that you're feeling.
It's hard, yeah.
It's really difficult because you have to then try and sort of like identify your feelings. And I'm not being funny. I mean, I know that I'm older than you, but none of us are ever sort of really given that equipment to sort of say, so this is how I'm feeling. What am I feeling? How do I navigate this? You know, that's not what we're given in society anyway. I mean, I know we're getting better at it now, but none of us have got the tools really to do this. And then smacking ADHD as well, or any sort of neurodivergence. And it's like, you know, you thought that you was going to cope, but by the way, you're going to feel like a magic eight ball that's been shaken like in an earthquake. So good luck. And this is sort of like where you're sort of left. And it's such a, honestly, the TikToks and the Instagram reels and all the other bits and pieces like that were how I found out the information. Like, not
that's
from
mad as well. Yeah, that's crazy.
Yeah, not from doctors, not from, you know, not again, not that they probably wouldn't have, but you're having to almost manage yourself in the doctors, say, this is what I think is wrong with me. Please, could you do this? Now, I'm not saying that they're necessarily going to work. If that's what you believe, then you need to do it. And so many people I know still, that I still chat to in my sort of circle that I go and see, and people like some of the girls that, you know, who do sort of like whatever I go and see them for, I think I could have it, you know, I think I could have it. And then they'll start reeling off things and I'm like, yeah, you are. And I'm like, well, go to the doctors. Like, but some of them are like, well, I don't really think a diagnosis is going to help me. Like, and I'm like, well, if it really isn't going to change anything for you, okay, I'd say there's no point really but understand that you are. But the problem, I think, whether as an adult, I think without the diagnosis, even if you fully believe it, like, and you're saying to people, you really, really don't fully, wholly believe it. Because it took me a long time to even accept it, because I kept thinking that almost someone was going to come and tap me on my shoulder and be like, not really, we were joking. And then you've made like all these fucking excuses about why you are the way you are. And someone's going to go, not really, we was only joking. You're just shit at life, love. But it isn't. You have to really like identify and sort of like think, oh. And it's hard. It is really hard to navigate. But if, like, you've seen it, go and look for it. Do you know what I mean? Look for the people that go and look on these people's TikToks.
It's good. This is kind of the reason I started the podcast, because it was the whole, and I realized it's going through it myself, that doctors don't actually, well, they do care. It's not nice that they don't care. They don't have the understanding, and the understanding comes from us. Why are we letting the world or waiting NHS to figure out what mental health is? We have the mental health. We should be sharing what the mental health is. It's between us as a community, and that's what TikTok has really captured, hasn't it? Compared to my Facebook, my Instagram, everything else, I have to be quite careful. I'd say mostly in Instagram of what I put up. There's a lot of reactions on Instagram. So if I put up like unfiltered ADHD, there'll be quite a lot of unfollowers and stuff people know. TikTok, you kind of grow. The more like weirder and stranger you are, the more of an audience you kind of get to it, doesn't it? But the other Facebook and Instagram are still like living in that masking era when everything, like especially Instagram, everything has to look tip-top, everything has to be professional, everything has to be accurate.
You can't pleasing, be isn't
saying
it?
Random rants.
Yeah.
And it's good to see that TikTok's got there. But as I said, there is a few out there that I'm thinking, oh my God, no, but please don't do it. But once the question is coming down to the diagnosis, isn't it? Everyone could say they have it, and people self-became to have the diagnosis. But to go through the diagnosis, as you said, it's a long-winded thing, and it's coupled with depression. It's coupled with a life of havoc, like and failures, and trying and error. Like it's a difference, isn't it? And it's just annoying sometimes when you see that people just trying to jump on the bandwagon. But at the end of the day, I feel better by thinking there's better to have awareness about it than them not saying anything about it. So I'd rather people be jumping on it and it be a hot topic than not be talking about like it was before. And everyone just think it's that, you know, you're just a naughty kid. You're just not going to get on. You can't concentrate. You can't do this. Like, we've come a long way. I think there's a long way to come.
I think as well.
Some doctor I know has compared it to schizophrenia.
No, as
seriousness, as debilitating.
Debilitating. Then yes, but I would say not in obviously the symptoms and stuff. But
as an effect, as quality of life, as how much it affects your life. Yeah.
I mean, it's classed as a disability, like in the UK, from what I'm sure it is, 99% sure it is. But even that, like when you're sort of like saying about how it affects you, like with work and stuff like that, like again, mine encompasses a lot of sort of like the trauma and stuff that I went through. But like even when you're saying these things to people, and, you know, how things have affected you. I mean, my job, the only jobs that I could ever do before, I did a couple of office jobs in my late teens, so my early working life. And I was like, fuck this. I can't stand being sat down behind a desk. Like, and then, so then I started doing like bar work and like restaurants and stuff, because I was moving around all the time because I could talk to people. And like, I loved like that, you know, chatting away and, you know, sort of, I loved that with people. So I could sort of like, you know, just make their day better. And I loved going about my day, but on the phone and doing some other stuff, it literally was like, oh my God, it was awful. And with the mental health stuff as well, like I know people and know people as well. And this is like in the circle that I've had that were diagnosed as BPD and it's ADHD. They have re-diagnosis now. Anxiety. And so my only thing is, and I'm no doctor. And again, please don't sort of stop taking your bloody medication and that. But I am someone that I think you have to really manage. I don't know how else to say, but manage the NHS almost, that if you honestly, truly believe that it could be something else, because you're seeing these TikToks and people may be dismissive. Oh my God, it's a TikTok. They're not a doctor. No, they're not. But our peers, the person has it. And they're living the same life as you. Whereas that doctor that sees you for 10 to 15 minutes, potentially, like your GP, if you're lucky, if in the 3 to 17 years that you get an appointment, like you have to then know what you need to say. So I would always urge people, go on the TikToks, look at them. And literally, if you really, really think you are, write down what you think you are, how, you know, it presents. And you talk to people that you know are, you know, diagnosed, you know, and ask their opinion.
And always write down the uncommon ones as well. So that would be my advice to go to people. You have to, two things you need to do. Obviously, I get this a lot because we go from where I've got like a lot of clients and stuff like that.
Yeah.
You have to harass them, and it's embarrassing, but you have to harass them. If you just go to them and you have to think of it from their point of view and just say, I think I've got ADHD, and they refer you and you leave it, and it's 6 months later, like, well, where's my appointment? They're going to think that it's not that detrimental. Yeah. If you have real ADHD, well, you probably might have, but you have to be fit every week. No, seriously, it's getting worse. Mm. I need something. I can't cope. And then that's how you get seen. And that scares people to be that forthcoming, because people think that they don't care like that. I shouldn't be that. There's other people out there that need my their doctor's attention.
No, I was just going to say, like, it's literally that, like, where it, like you say, it can be quite dismissed, or you think, oh, I don't want to be a bother. I don't want to bother anyone, because it is only ADHD. Yeah. But let me tell you, like, before I really had my diagnosis, like, and again, I know and I'm aware that this comes in, it does encompass my trauma and stuff, but I knew that just because I couldn't function the way people normally could, I was really suicidal at one point. I was really suicidal. And, I've never really been like anxiety as such, but I've like, I would say like depression and things. And I would say that the twice in my life that I've ever had it was postnatally. And that I think again is because of my ADHD, because it was such a shock to my system. But I remember sort of like feeling like really bad, like a couple of years ago, again, when I started all of this and getting the sort of diagnosis and stuff. And I was like, I feel really awful. Like, I'm really, like, why am I so depressed? Like, and things were okay for me and stuff. And I just couldn't understand it. And then for me, I started my medication for ADHD. And I'm not joking. Whoosh. It was like a weight had been taken off my shoulders. And I was like, oh. And then
did you feel like the world sinked into place for once?
Yeah, 100%. Because when you take it, and sort of like then obviously rather than, I always describe it, I remember saying this to you. So there's a film called The Fifth Element. It's like futuristic, right? So you've got a futuristic city, even if you don't know what that film is, a futuristic city, flying cars, and there's like thousands going in all directions, right? That's an ADHD brain. Take that medication. Yes, you've still got the flying cars, but they're slower and there's very, very few of them. Yeah. They've sort of calmed down. And when I started taking it, it was almost this like, how fucking dare any of you that don't have ADHD or aren't neurodivergent tell me that I shouldn't be getting it this hard or feeling this bad? Because if your brains are like this and even better than this, normally, fuck you. Just fuck you. Because it was like, oh my God. Literally like,
no, it's true.
This massive realization, Nate, like, and I was just like, wow. And this is why for me,
I had that at 11 and I hated everyone ever since. Wow.
I can't even imagine that. Like, I don't know about you, but you can see the people like who aren't that bothered by it. So when you meet people and you're chatting and they're like, oh, I think I might be, and you're like, oh, okay. But then you can look at the people and you know that it's seriously affecting them. And I always say to them, people, please go and get a diagnosis. Please do that for yourself.
What would you say for females, like specifically, because I can't really talk on that aspect, but like going, especially the elder females, because this is a common thread right now, late female diagnosis of ADHD. What would you say, as in advice-wise, if you're feeling a certain way, what to do? Like, what advice would you give everyone?
So I would literally, as I said, go on the TikToks, look at the TikToks, right? It's not silly. It's not stupid. Mm-hmm. You know, people have found out that they've got blooming cancers from things like that. It's not, you know, don't underestimate the power of social media. I'm not saying that they're all fantastic, as we know, like as in like the resources, but keep going.
Mostly good.
The two that I used were Kobe Watts. He's an Australian guy and he does a lot of skits and a lot of videos, and Connor DeWolf, an American young, they're both young, quite young men. But they put on a lot of their stuff, and that's where I got my information from. There's probably a lot more females out there now that are actually, and I, because I don't really need the information, I've never really looked now. But I would say, go and do your homework. Go and do your homework. Look at what it is. Talk to people if you know that they are diagnosed around you, at your gym, at your doctor's surgery, wherever, and ask them. And then 9 times out of 10, if you speak to another neurodivergent person, they'll be looking at you. And I don't know about you, Nate, but within seconds, if someone's talking to me, I'm like, yep, they've got it. Yep. And I can look around and I'm like, yep. Just again, the leg shaking, anything.
Yeah.
And I would say, even if you're not going to get medication, you don't have to, but even if you're not going to do that, find out for yourself. Find out just so that you stop hating yourself, so that you stop self-loathing because you forget, you know, your kids like non-uniform day, or because you forget that you needed to pay this bill at that time. Please stop hating on yourself, because it isn't your fault and it doesn't go away. And the medication doesn't magically make it any better in the sense of like, it won't disappear, but there are ways that you'll find for yourself to cope, you know, and for me, it's really improved my life. It's massively, massively improved my life to know, to have the information, because when I'm sort of having one of my mad days and la, 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 rather than, I used to sort of think, oh God, what am I doing? I'm just talking all the time. And I'd hate myself walking away from something. Whereas now I'll be like, la, 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 and then I'll just go skipping off. Like, because it's just me. It's just part of who I am. Yeah. And they can accept
that's it. It's part of it, don't I don't know if you've got this since you've kind of been open with it as well. I've got a lot, since I've been just spinning it and done it, especially like the videos and stuff, and I've got a very different response from like the people I know and stuff like that, which is very different. Like, it's kind of where before I think I was seen as a loose cannon, which couldn't be trusted of everything. Now it's kind of like, oh, he's got his shit together. He's really done it. Like, it's kind of a different approach. Once you could be a corporate advocate for ADHD, more so, isn't it? Like, I've kind of sensed that it's kind of a better role. Like, I mean, like, and as you're going back to saying about the diagnosis, I think one of the easiest ways to get diagnosed is if you know someone with ADHD, ask them, because they'll know all the hidden things that won't be shown on TikTok, even if you're cured. And no one's gonna, that's all closed doors.
It's in here.
But when you start seeing that in, like, you know, the books, the diaries, the
like with all the ways that I'm sort of, I'm lucky now that I've got people in my life that I can rely on and that help me, but I am better at doing these things. But obviously things still get missed. I still miss appointments, and, you know, sort of my daughter's a diabetic, and that team I've had to work really closely with because of making sure that, so again, the same sort of thing, Nicola, remember you're coming in tomorrow, and you know, you get the text messages or the reminders, and they're so fantastic for me. And before and originally, I probably would have felt quite ashamed for that. But I don't anymore. I don't. It's just how I need to do it.
Yeah.
You know, I'd feel ashamed more for not turning up. Yeah, it is. It's literally your survival. Yeah. And sometimes everything will come crashing down. That's life. Sometimes it won't, you know. And it's literally just what you can find that works for you, that's the best thing. And for me and you, that might be totally different. And again, it's like you said, like you forgot the time, but I knew it. And it's just about knowing that there's no judgment coming from me for anyone that's neurodivergent, none whatsoever. And to be honest, like, I would always say to people, like, sort of like I said to you, like, go and do your research, contact anyone. As again, most people, even online, even if you haven't got people in your life, like, it, do you think this, do you think that? We're not doctors, we're peers. So we might you know, we might be able to help you and signpost you. I'll do that for anyone that ever needs it. You know, I think as well, the only other advice that I would always say to people, and I would say this to people, whether they're neurotypical or neurodivergent, but give up the drink because it's doing you absolutely no good and everything else that comes with that. And that's not to be a party pooper, but I promise you the sober lifestyle is absolutely fantastic because you just start to like yourself. Yeah, it's amazing. And the sober community and
you don't cover ever. You have to deal with yourself every day.
Yep. And you don't ever want to, you don't have to do anything like drinking and stuff because you're you like who you are. So then because you're then learning about this and you're sort of equipped to do it, like you say, but go to the gym. The gym's hugely helped me with my confidence, with confidence in life, not just in the gym, but in everything. Oh, if I can lift that, I can do that. And to people that, so again, this would be another episode of the podcast. But what I will say is coming out of domestic abuse, as horrific as that was, as awful as the things that happened after and things that I've dealt with, going sober has been one of the biggest changes for me, finding out my ADHD and managing that and liking myself and not berating myself for getting things wrong. And talk therapy, just offload. I don't do it anymore, but I needed it and I'm thankful that I did. The gym, again, I go, it's just, I don't want to say it's addictive, but it's the improvement in my mental health from going to the gym, for my ADHD, for everything, for my trauma recovery, for who I am as a person, the self-belief is amazing. And although people might be fearful of going to the gym, let me tell you that 99% of the people in that gym have had the same thoughts as you. So they may not be neurodivergent, but everyone is battling their own demons. My daughter, because it's nearly my 2-year anniversary, my daughter posted something about me and it was, you know, her in admiration of me, you know, my 16-year-old daughter, about how well that she's done and how proud of me that she is. And she's done this TikTok and it's me, not real. I mean, when you see the pictures, there's literally me, how I look 99% of the time, literally in a pair of leggings and a hoodie with no makeup on. So you'll see that. But literally, it was just this appreciation of, like, almost like a thank you for becoming sober, for doing all this. And I do put that not just for the being sober, but for the ADHD as well, of who I am. So if I could give anyone advice, I would be just stop hating yourself for first and then go looking, go seeking, and you will find, let me tell you.
Good. So I don't really find a way to sign this out yet. So till next time, we will.
Yep.
We'll see.
Thank you. Anyone can contact me and that, you know, and send me a message. And if I can,
I'll put all the details and the links and stuff in there.
Yeah. So, fingers crossed. If you need anything else, let me know.